Okay, let's unmute Alaa. Fingers crossed, everybody.
You hear me now, right?
Yes.
Very
yes,
good.
Yes, I can hear you, Alaa. I can hear you, and there's no feedback. It's a miracle. Oh, my goodness. You guys, thank you so much for your exceptional patience through this really bumpy beginning. So everybody, we can all take a deep breath now. So that's good. Catch our breaths for a second. I'm going to like fully start because we're going to cut this and throw it up on YouTube later.
Okay.
We'll pretend this never happened. We'll start it clean. And thank you guys. Thank you all so much for hanging in through this. Good evening. Welcome. I'm Susanna Hermans, co-owner of Oblong Books in Millerton and Rhinebeck, New York. Tonight we are over the moon to welcome Alaa Al Aswany and Dinaw Mengestu in conversation about Alaa's new novel, The Republic of False Truths. This event is presented in partnership with Bard Written Arts. And I know Dinaw is going to give a proper intro, but Alaa is the author of numerous books, including The Jacobian Building, which is the best-selling novel in the Arab world for more than 5 years, with more than 1 million copies sold around the world. He'll be in conversation with Dinaw, who, is, among many other things, is the recipient of a MacArthur Fellowship. He's the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Professor of Humanities at Bard College and Director of their Written Arts Program. Gentlemen, it is an absolute pleasure to be here with you tonight. Both of our authors' books are available for purchase at oblongbooks.com or via the Buy the Book button at the bottom of your screen. And also feel free to throw questions for our authors in the chat or in the Ask a Question feature at the bottom of your screen. Thank you both so much. I'm going to go away for a little while.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Suzanne. And wonderful to be here with you again, Alaa. It's been a few years since we've had a chance to talk with one another. And remember the last time we was here at Bard and we had a wonderful conversation with our students. So I'm happy to have that conversation once more with you around your new novel. I thought maybe we could start the conversation with a very brief reading of the text in Arabic, and then I'll just read the same text in English, just so people can hear the language in its original. I think it gives so much life to the text to actually be able to hear the way it was composed and constructed in your head. And then just for context, I'll reframe it very briefly, and then we can jump into the conversation.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be with you, my dear friend. As you said, the last time we were together was at Bard College a few years ago. Thank you for coming, and I'm very happy to be with you. Now, I'm going to read in Arabic for a couple of minutes, and then you probably will follow this with reading, English reading, for the same part of the text. This is a start of the novel. This is the beginning of the novel. لا يحتاج اللواء أحمد علواني إلى جرس المنبه. ما أن يؤذن لصلاة الفجر حتى يستيقظ وحده. يظل مستلقيا في الفراش مفتوح العينين يهمس بكلمات الأذان ثم ينهض إلى الحمام فيتوضأ على عجل ويصفف شعره الأسود المصبوغ بعناية ما عدا شريطين ضيقين متساويين من الشيب يتركهما على جانبي الرأس ثم يرتدي بدلته الرياضية الأنيقة ويتوجه إلى المسجد المجاور. طلب منه قائد الحرس أكثر من مرة إنشاء مسجد داخل الفيلا حتى تسهل حمايته، لكن اللواء علواني رفض. يحب دائما أن يصلي وسط الناس مثل أي شخص عادي. يجتاز الشارع سائرا على قدميه وهو محاط بأربعة من أفراد الحرس يرقبون الطريق وأسلحتهم جاهزة للإطلاق في أي لحظة، ثم يتفرقون عند باب المسجد، فيبقى اثنان في الخارج بينما يظل الحارسان الآخران واقفين داخل المسجد يحرسانه وهو يصلي. في تلك اللحظات النورانية المباركة يفارق اللواء علواني يفارق اللواء علواني عالمنا إلى دنيا أخرى يستغرقه خشوع عميق صادق، فلا يرى أفراد الحراسة ولا المصلين ولا يفكر في منصبه ولا أولاده وزوجته، يحمل حذاءه تحت إبطه مثل أي مصلي ويمشي مطرقا حتى يصل إلى ركن بعيد فيؤدي ركعتين تحية المسجد ثم ركعتين سنة الصبح ويستمر في التسبيح والاستغفار حتى تقام الصلاة، على الرغم من إلحاح المصلين فإن اللواء علواني رفض دائما إمامتهم وهو يصر على الصلاة في الصف الأخير، يطرق خاشعا وكثيرا ما تنهمر دموعه عندما تولى الإمام آيات القرآن، يتلو الإمام آيات القرآن بصوته العذب الرخيم.
Thank you, Alaa.
You're welcome, dear.
General Ahmad Alwani had no need of an alarm clock. The moment the dawn prayer was called, he'd wake up of his own accord. He'd lie on his back in bed, eyes open, repeating the words of the call in a whisper, then rise and go to the bathroom where he'd quickly perform his ablutions, comb his black hair, carefully dyed, apart from two thin white streaks of equal length that he left, one on each side. Then don his chic tracksuit and set off for the nearby mosque. The security detail had asked him more than once to put up a mosque inside the villa so that he could be more easily protected, but General Alwani refused. He liked to pray alongside everyone else, just like an ordinary person. So he'd cross the street on foot, surrounded by four members of his guard who kept their eyes on the road, weapons poised to fire at any moment. At the door to the mosque, the guards split up, two staying outside while the other two stood inside, guarding him while he prayed. During those blessed, radiant moments, General Alwani would leave our world for another. A deep and genuine humility would flood over him. His guards and the other worshippers would disappear from before his eyes, and he would cease to think of his job or his children or his wife. Placing his shoes under his arm like any other worshipper, he would walk, head bowed, to a distant corner, perform the two prostrations of greeting to the mosque, followed by two more in accordance with the Prophet's morning custom, and then continue uttering thanks to God and entreaties for forgiveness until the collective prayer commenced. Despite the pressing requests of the other worshippers, General Alwani always refused to lead them, insisting instead on praying in the back row, head bowed in submission, the tears often gushing from his eyes when the imam recited in a sweet and melodious voice verses from the Quran. Prayer liberated him, made him feel as though he were a new person. His soul became limpid, his worries drifted away, and a sense of serenity came over him as though the prayer were a draught of cool water offered him when thirsty in the heat of the day. The world ceased to have any importance in his eyes and shrank to the size of a gnat's wings. He would wonder at men's struggles over their selfish interests, their panting after passing pleasures. Why all the scrapping and the competition? What was the point of all the lying, the envy and plotting? Were we not all merely travelers on the road? Were we not in the end all dead men? Would we not one day lay ourselves down in the moist earth while our souls ascended to their maker, that he might hold us to account for our deeds? On that day, neither rank nor wealth will avail us, and naught will save us but good works. I love that opening scene, and I love that opening passage, and the character of the general that emerges from there. And I suppose part of what I thought we could use that scene for as an introduction is to maybe step back from the text for a second, and perhaps ask you to sort of explain the very sort of complicated and circuitous sort of path that you've taken to become who you are. You began first as a dentist in Egypt, but then really quickly began to develop a career as a novelist, as an essayist, as a critic, as a cultural reporter, and then with the publication of the Yacoubian, international figure, somebody whose voice on the sort of international stage when initially was around East. And from there, things have sort of changed. And I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about just how this, how your path as a writer has changed and evolved up to the moment of beginning to write this particular book, which was, if I'm correct, written largely in the United States in exile, and how that process has changed and emerged for you.
Well, this book was written at Bard College while I was teaching over there, you know, so I used to wake up early and I finished the novel at Bard. I'm not, you know, being a writer was my only dream when I was a kid. I always wanted to be a novelist. My father was a novelist too, and I was an only kid. I was very much attached to my father. So that was my dream. And when I had to go to the university, my father advised me of studying something other than literature, because he told me in a dictatorship, you should be an independent writer. And you cannot be an independent writer without having another profession. And that's how I became a dentist. And I never regret it, because it has been very useful to me. First, it has enabled me to be independent. I was always paid by my patients or my readers. I was never paid by the government. Accordingly, I was always able to write whatever I want. It's a profession, dentistry, through which you will be exposed to a real human experience. You have very different people coming to fix their teeth, to treat their teeth, and I love that. They become my friends, I listen to them, and of course it has been very useful to be a dentist. The fact that because of this novel, I quit. I had to flee Egypt, because since Mr. Sisi arrived to power, I was banned from writing anywhere in Egypt. I was banned from any TV appearance. There was a very tough propaganda against me, media campaign against myself as a writer. With this novel, while I began this novel in Egypt, half of the novel, and then I terminated this novel at Bard, as I told you. With the second, when I wrote the first chapter, and I began to write the second chapter, I write very early in the morning, and then usually during lunch, my wife asks me how is the writing, and I told her the writing is fine. I finished the first chapter. This chapter we read from, but I think we will leave the country, and I did accept it, and when this novel, which was not, of course, published in Egypt, it was published in Lebanon. When it was published, I had really problems, and I had a military case against me in a military court because of the novel. To my knowledge, this is the first time to bring a novelist to a military court in Egypt because of one of his novels.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. the novel actually sort of preceded the exile, or maybe another way of framing that is the novel, you know, writing the novel was kind of, you knew in the construction, even of particularly of this character, that you were treading and entering into dangerous territory, that the character themselves and the sort of fictional characters become the cause of a real life exile, that the construction of them, as you imagine them, you are already aware of what the consequences to you, Alaa, the writer, the human being, are going to be. And so I'm wondering if you could talk to us a little bit about the decision to continue with that narrative and how that maybe influences or the challenges that then come along with writing, continuing to write, knowing at that early stage that to finish this book means to basically resign yourself to exile.
I have had problems. Thank you for the question. I have had problems all my life because of what I wrote. I disagreed because I was defending democracy, and there was never a democratic regime. The last democratic regime in Egypt was 1952. Almost democratic. But so I had all those troubles. That's not my, I was excluded. I never had any award. I had 18 awards all over the world, literary awards, very prestigious, but no one single award from Egypt. And I don't care, you know. This is a price of writing, and I'm very willing to pay this price. And why? Because I know what writing is all about, and I know what does it mean to be a writer. And I always wanted to be a real writer. And a real writer should say always what he thinks. And here there is a wonderful quote by Ernesto Guevara. He said, honor is to say always what you think and to do always what you say. And I try to do that. So I don't regret at all.
Character, and then begin to think about, because the novel is written from multiple different perspectives and it includes lots of different experiences and realities, both around the revolution and before the revolution. But in this construction of the general who we sort of heard a little bit from, who is a, you know, as his title sort of suggests, an authoritarian, military, violent figure. And I was struck not by those qualities, right? But even in the passage that you sort of read, the general's, your conception of him, because there's gestures of sort of definitely humanizing and kind of tenderness, and understanding of, I felt this sort of profound kind of isolation and loneliness around him, that for all of the power that he obviously has amassed, that his relationship both to himself, to his faith, to his family, that there's something kind of hollow through a lot of these things, and that he moves through the world in a kind of solitude. So I was wondering about maybe, is it an attempt to try to humanize him, or do you see him as being somebody sort of beyond that type of redemption? Because when he's violent, the violence is excessive, right? It's, I mean, his violence, not the narration of it.
Yeah, you as a novelist know that we don't have to judge the people. Literature is a wonderful tool to teach us not to judge the people, but instead to try to understand the people in a better way. So I don't judge my characters. This is one. Two, I have been always inspired by life, by real people. And you can my formula is fiction equal reality plus imagination. So there is always a real origin in my fiction. And this, if we talk about General Alwani, I was inspired by real people. You know, I saw some generals who are doing this. And they don't feel that they are hypocrites at all. And this is a big problem because the world literature presented the religious hypocrisy, you see. And we have a wonderful, unique example, Tartuffe by Molière. Somebody who pretends to be religious. Our problem, I would say, not only in Egypt, but in the Muslim world, because I believe this is one of the complications of the dictatorship. Our problem is this, that people do not pretend. People are really religious, but their interpretation of religion doesn't prevent them from doing terrible things like the General Alwani. He doesn't feel, he feels that he really is a good Muslim, and he's justifying to himself the crimes he is committing. So this is a problem. And as I told you, I was inspired by real people. Ironically and sadly in the same time, we have in Egypt a department called the security state. The security state is where the people are, the political prisoners are terribly tortured to get confessions. And many times they give confessions just to stop the torture, right? If you go there, ironically, you will find a place for prayer in every floor. And you will find the officers who are torturing the helpless detainees. They stop the torture to make the prayer. And here, it is beyond a person who has a kind of criminal behavior. No, the problem is very huge. It's a problem of the interpretation of the religion.
I was thinking almost that the religion almost becomes, and this, I think you can find this in all faiths, not just in Islam, but that the religion in this case can be sort of manipulated and then becomes a cover for all sorts of political actions. So there's a quote from the text that I put in the chat. The general lay down on the sofa and began running his prayer beads through his fingers, saying, "I seek refuge with God from lapidated Satan." Why did he feel oppressed? And I was struck by that idea that the general, who is obviously, you know, both the perpetrator of violence and the kind of symbol of an authoritarian oppression, himself can feel oppressed. But that made me sort of pair the general. There's another really fascinating character along the lines of religion, which is that of the sheikh. And the sheikh plays this very interesting role, but there's one line that he says in this public performance where Sheikh Shamel says to an audience, "We Muslims are subject to a general conspiracy that aims to distance us from our religion." And later the general says, "First, by virtue of my position within the states, I can assure you that there's a general conspiracy against Egypt." So here was the sudden interesting conflation, right, of both on the one hand, in one part of the society, there's the general as the military figure, and then here's the sheikh as the religious figure. and whether they know it or not, they're both parroting the same language, right? They're both using a particular type of vocabulary and discourse. So I wonder if you could talk about like the, how conscious is that among, do you think, among the society, among, you know, religious figures and military figures, to employ religion as almost a tool to make all sorts of behavior permissible, and how much of it stems, I don't know, from maybe something less, more innocent.
Yeah, okay. I see your point. No, no, you have a point here. That's very important. You know, the problem is the privilege, is the class, is the social class, right? And Mr. General Alwani is defending the class, is defending the ruling class in Egypt, is defending the regime, is defending his own privilege. And Sheikh Shamil is the religious aspect of the same procedure, you know? It's like, I am defending this regime by torturing the opponents, and the other side, Sheikh Shamil, is defending the regime by just putting the religion on the side of the rich people, you see. Accordingly, in the core, they are both doing the same thing. Even if they don't realize, sometimes they don't realize, because they must justify what they're doing to themselves. The revolution in Egypt was a very, very important moment, because it was a moment of truth. So we saw these people like Sheikh Shamil condemning strongly the revolution from the very first day. Why? Because the revolution means that we don't accept anymore your privilege. We are all equal citizens, and we should be. Accordingly, anybody in Egypt who is related to the police, a police officer or an army officer or a judge, mostly he will be against the revolution. Why? Because if he doesn't understand, he feels that those revolutionary youth want everybody, all people, to be equal, which is not the case, of course. You know, a judge or a police officer or an army officer is somebody, is a master in Egypt, and every other person in Egypt is less. Accordingly, you could see really this struggle between the revolution and the old guards, because the old guards, the revolution was trying and is trying, because I believe the revolution is not done yet, but the revolution is trying to get rid of the whole regime, not only the political, the way of thinking, our thoughts about the woman rights, the veil, the religion, everything. At some point, we dreamed of getting rid of all the regime and building a new fair Egypt.
I'm very happy that you brought up the sort of the scale of what we mean and what you mean really by the revolution, that it's not just about it's not just about the sort of changing of a political class or of a political structure, but the kind of reimagining of a society. And in particular, the book makes a sort of noted effort to sort of focus on upending and overturning, you know, the relationships between genders, right? The role of women in society, the sort of perceptions of women in society, and that as being, you know, perhaps one of the sort of fundamental linchpins to understanding what needs to happen, right? Because that relationship is obviously very sort of intimate, and it exists in the very sort of domestic scale And so I was wondering if you can talk about that, about how you imagine the revolution as being something that's very also sort of the transformation as being gendered, as something that is overturning this sort of structural system that has been around for so long, it seems almost impossible to shake.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I'll tell you something. I'll tell you just something that I saw myself. A few days after the revolution and obliged Mubarak to step down, there was a referendum. And this referendum was March 19, just after the revolution. It was organized by the army. I don't trust any referendum or elections organized by the army. And I believe the last free elections in Egypt was January 1950. Anyway, so people stayed in line to vote. And I saw that. And then the governor of Cairo came. And of course, usually he doesn't stay in line. He's a governor, right? So he tried just to pass from the other side to vote without staying in line. And people, very ordinary people, said, hey, wait. They talked to the governor of Cairo, right? You want to vote? And he said, yes. And then they told him, you must stay in line. And he said, you know what? I would have liked to stay in line, but I have an appointment with the Marechal Tantawi. The Marechal Tantawi is, by that time, was in charge, was ruling the country. And the answer by ordinary, simple people was what? You know what? They told the governor, if Marechal Tantawi will come here to vote, he must stay in line. And then he quit. He couldn't stand it. So this is the revolution. Just an example, something I saw. Accordingly, I can understand why the people in power, why the people with the privilege in Egypt, they really hate the revolution in a terrible way, because they feel threatened, and they are right. The revolution is a threat to them.
In that idea of the revolution as being a threat to the institutions in power. The phrasing that was there with both the general and the sheikh framing the idea that there is a kind of threat, that there's a conspiracy against Islam, the conspiracy against the country, and that in order to protect the country, these men need to remain in power because there's something happening out there. And that even that term of the conspiracy, we live right now, it seems, in an age of conspiracy, in an age of conspiracies that are sort of, you know, destroying this country and that are sort of, you know, pervasive and malicious in their intent. And I was once struck by that similarity and was wondering if you thought of that, if you were sort of thinking there are echoes of these places, right? And so when we think of the politics in Egypt, that they're maybe not always that particularly different from our own domestic politics here in America. And that too, we oftentimes imagine the conspiracy as being something that happens almost organically, that it arises from the people. But in fact, in your novel, you're actually seeing how the idea of the conspiracy always originates on top, right? It originates from power, and it's used by power to maintain power. Whereas it then presents itself as being about the people, right? Or as being something that originates within the people, or to protect the people, but it has very little to do with that.
Yeah, the conspiracy theory has been always a wonderful tool for fascism. When you are fascist, when you don't believe in democracy, when you are ruling either the country or the minds of the people in a fascist way, the idea of conspiracy is a Christmas present. I mean, it's wonderful. Why? Because if I convince you that there is a conspiracy against the country, right? You, if you will be convinced, you will postpone any criticism whatsoever, because we are facing a real conspiracy. And you will allow me to violate the human rights as much as I can, as much as I wish, because I'm defending you, you see. And you, if I will fail as a president or a king or a ruler, I will never be to blame. There is a conspiracy, right? So we had a terrible defeat, 1967. The worst defeat in the history of Egypt in 6,000 years, right? And the dictator by that time talked about the conspiracy. You see, that there was a conspiracy. What can I do? In Islam, not in the Islamists, the political Islam groups, they always convince the young people there is a very big conspiracy. In Egypt now, in the media, all the media is a state media now in Egypt. You know, no one single word is written in Egypt or said on TV without an approval by the army, right? They say that the people who are against Mr. Sisi, they are traitors. They are all CIA agents, right? So the conspiracy has been used over and over and over by every fascist ruler and every fascist regime, even the religious rulers, the religious leaders.
Just to remind the audience out there, if you have questions, please feel free to begin to put them in the chat. We'd love to hear your questions. I've many more, but I already get the pleasure of talking to you. Yes, so I'd love to make sure.
Thank you.
Along the same ideas, I was thinking there's a character, Ashraf, who was a kind of failed actor, imagines himself to be an aspiring writer and novelist, and a wonderful quote that he has, where he says he wasn't trying to persuade his readers of anything. He just wanted to show them how many are the lies that we live. And I was wondering about that quote. If how you see that particular character, because he's you know, like all of the characters, a very complicated presence where he has these moments and these traits, like moments like that, where he's quite sympathetic. But yet at the other times, he's obviously a deeply flawed character. So one, do you see him, do you imagine the novel and this particular story as being almost a kind of anti-conspiracy text, in that if the conspiracy is trying to persuade you of a threat that's not real or imagined, that the novel, in trying to not persuade you really of anything, other than the fact that there are a sort of a wealth of lies, that the novel functions, and perhaps part of one of the reasons why it's such a threat, and why this book might have been, you know, why you knew it was going to be such a threat to the state, because its intention is to function almost as an antidote to the idea of the conspiracy.
I learned, you know, not to just judge people in literature and in life. And people who are considered losers in any society, sometimes I listen to them. I know many of them. I don't think they are losers, you know. Sometimes they are, as the stereotype is presenting them. They are lazy, they don't want to work, etc. But many times they just stood by their principles, and they refused to get integrated in a Hippocratic machine or a corrupt machine. So I believe that literature is a wonderful tool for us to understand, between brackets, the losers, because they are not losers. They are losers in the opinion of the mainstream thinking in any society. But if you know them individually, and this happened to me many times here in France, in Egypt, I have many many friends who are losers. I have probably few friends who are successful people, you know. But I learned from them, because they made the difficult choice, right? Many of them. They wanted to keep their self-respect, and they refused just to say yes, so that they would get integrated in the system. And I think Ashraf, if you're talking about my character, is one of them, you see.
Yeah. There's a question about the relationship you have to your translators. Of what relationship, if any, do you have with them?
Well, it depends. I can evaluate the translation in English, French, and Spanish. Other languages, I cannot evaluate the translation, and I'm not the one who decides about the translation. It's the publishing house. Of course, I must approve the choice, but it's the job of the publishing house. But I have been lucky with my French and English translators, because there are more than one, and in French translator, I have only one, and he's wonderful. I can tell because I read French, you see. For the other languages, I get the feedback from some friends to tell me if the translation is good. Because you know what? The literary translation is much more than just finding the meaning of the words. A literary translator must be capable to reproduce the text, reproduce the original text in another language. So it's not easy. So as I said, I've been lucky with my translators generally.
Yeah. Hi guys, I'm back.
Hi, welcome.
This has been such an extraordinary discussion. Dinaw, did you have any last?
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed it very much. And I must thank you, because you made it happen, and I must thank you, Dinaw, my dear friend, because of this, the wonderful way he moderated the event, and very good questions, and thank you all, and thank you, really.
Thank you both. Thank you so much, Dinaw, for stepping in this evening to
help
absolutely.
Us. And
Alaa, congratulations on your book. It has received incredible praise around the world.
Thank you very much.
And we are so honored to have you with us tonight. I'll remind folks,
thank you very much,
that we have books available from both Dinaw and Alaa at oblongbooks.com, or ask for them at your local independent bookstore. Thank you all so much for joining us tonight, and have a wonderful and safe evening.
Bye bye.
Thank you. Bye bye, Alaa. Wonderful
thank
to see you.
Thank you, Dinaw. Good to see you. Very happy to see you.